Hello and welcome to the today's session. Today we will discuss about Baby Kamlesh, the prison we broke. This is the new session of Dalit Discourse, and the prison we broke is an autobiography written by most famous writer of Marathi, Baby Kamlesh. So let us discuss about the various aspects of this autobiography written by Baby Kamlesh. First at all, we have to know about the brief biography of Baby Kamlesh. Baby Kamlesh was born in 1929. She worked as an activist in Phaltan. Phaltan is a small town in Satara district of Maharashtra. She is a veteran of the Dalit movement in Maharashtra. Inspired by the radical leadership of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, she has been involved with the struggle from a very young age. Later, she went on to establish a government-approved residential school for socially backward students in Nimbure. Nimbure is a small village near Phaltan. She has published a collection of poetry. She has been honored with several awards for her literary and social work. She passed away on 21st of April 2012. Let us discuss about the autobiography written by Baby Kamlesh. Baby Kamlesh's autobiographical work, The Prison We Broke, it was originally written in Marathi and published in 2008. As Jina Amucha, and later it was translated into English by Maya Pandit. It is considered as the manifesto of Dalit women. Maya Pandit observes the autobiography as an expression of protest against the inhuman conditions of existence to which the Hindu caste system has subjected the Dalit for thousands of years. Kamlesh's autobiography deals with three major issues of the society. And these three major issues, which have been discussed by Baby Kamlesh in her autobiography, are first, the oppressions and exploitations of Dalit by the upper class. The second one is the discriminations towards Dalit women in a patriarchal society. And the next one is the influence of Dr. Ambedkar and the narrator and her fellow women. So let us discuss one by one these three aspects and these three issues which have been arisen by the writer. The first issue arised by the writer in her autobiography is the issues of the oppression and exploitation of Dalit by the upper class. Kamlesh writes that caste discrimination was prevalent and the poor Mahars were forced to live under it. The Mahars were treated as untouchable servants, askars. By doing askar jobs, they would get bhakris. Bhakris is a leftover food and which they eat after drying them in the sun. The Mahars were not allowed to use the regular road that was used by the upper castes. Kamlesh writes, I quote, "When somebody from this caste walked from the opposite direction, the Mahars had to leave the road, climb down in the shrubbery and walk through the thorny bushes on the roadside," unquote. The Mahar women would beg for the mercy of the upper caste. Every new bride had to adapt and follow this custom. If they failed, they would be severely warned by the upper caste as well as Mahars. If anyone failed to beg for mercy of the upper caste, the master would simply explode in rage and come straight to the Mahachowdi and call the new bride a shameless bitch. Kamlesh writes, I quote, "Who just tell me, who the hell is that new girl? Doesn't she know that she has to bow down to the master? Shameless bitch. How dare she pass me without showing due to respect?" Unquote. The elderly women from the Mahar community would fall on the feet of the master and beg for his mercy. The poor Mahar would request the master, "No, no kind master, the girl is a new animal in the hut. Quite foolish and ignorant. If she has ate, I, her sasra, fall at your feet, but Farge was for his this crime." Unquote. Here we see that the newly married bride is called an animal in the hut, and whatever she did is treated as crime. The next issue which Baby Kamble arrived in her autobiography is the issues of the description towards Dalit women in a patriarchal society. The position of Dalit women in her family, which she charred by insecurity, domestic and social violence, is the major theme of Kamble's autobiography. So the patriarchal system in India made the Dalit women feel insecure and dependent on men. Stating the importance of sons in a family, Baby Kamble writes, I quote, "The eldest son was the pride of the house. He would be offered to the deity as Vaghya or court raja." Unquote. "The eldest son are given high priority while the prestige of daughters is not considered by the parents." Another aspect of domestic violence that Dalit women experience is the hegemony of husband and the dominance of in-laws at the bridegroom's place. Baby Kamble states how marriage takes place among Dalit families even when the bride or bridegrooms are very young. She writes, I quote, "Thus, girl would embark upon a new life that was harsh and arduous. She was a young girl, a child really, still immature, yet the poor child had to break all ties of love and go to her in-laws house to lead a married life without even knowing what a husband meant or what it was to be given away." Unquote. Baby Kamble cites specific examples of the relations between a bride and her mother-in-law. As soon as the bride arrives at her in-laws home, she would be asked to make two baskets full bhakris. The new bride is not allowed to sleep until she completes the entire household duties. A woman would falsely accuse her daughter-in-law of doing deeds. She would not even comprehend driving the young girl to death and coaxing her son into remarrying a widow. Baby Kamble provides psychological reasons for this behavior being one where the woman being incapable of projecting her pent-up emotions towards the society finds solace in her victory over an inferior being, even if it is at the cost of her life. She illustrates, I quote, "The other world had bound us with chains of slavery, but we too were human beings and we too desire to dominate, to wield power, but who would let us do that? So we made our own arrangements to find slaves, our very own daughter-in-law. If nobody else, then we could at least enslave them." Unquote. Baby Kamble also deals with the internalization of patriarchy in her autobiography. A Dalit woman who experienced the patriarchy and caste shows authority over her daughter-in-law. She writes, I quote, "In those days, at least one woman in 100 would have her nose chopped off. You may well ask why. It is because of the sasu, the grandmother, who would poison her son's mind. These sasus ruined the lives of innocent women forever. They had no food to eat, no proper clothing to cover their bodies. Their hair would remain uncombed and tangled. Dry from lack of oil, women led the most miserable existence. And when any of these daughter-in-laws would try to run away to escape this torture, her husband or in-laws would beat her to a pulp. Even her brother or father would flog her mercilessly and ask in-laws to take her back. The poor girl, numb with pain and hunger, was forced to return to her husband's home." Unquote. Baby Kamble, being a Dalit woman, provides a remarkable account of Dalit woman's point of view and the importance of education in her autobiography. This is the impact of the teachings of Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar, and by which Baby Kamble and her fellow women were influenced. So she is strongly inspired by the thoughts and philosophy of Dr. Ambedkar on education from her childhood days. And Baby Kamble's father and brother were parts of Ambedkar's socio-political activities, and they used to closely discuss and everyday activities of Ambedkar. Baby used to take part in all those discussions. Eventually, she became an Ambedkarite. She has taken a pledge to educate her community and critique the myths, superstitions, and Hinduism. She recollects the speech of Dr. Ambedkar. I quote, "My brothers and sisters, all you folks, including the old men, women, and children who have come to Jejuri far off places, you walked barefoot for 8 to 10 days to get here. While on the way, you were tired, you were fatigued, you had nothing but a few stale pieces of bhakri to eat. Yet you kept on walking and finally reached Jejuri. Why? Because you wanted to see your family, Diti Khandova. But tell me, did Khandova see you? Could he see your condition? Did he see your suffering? What good has this God ever done to you?" Unquote. Baby Kamble writes how the Dalits had been asked to follow a different path after the speech delivered by Ambedkar. She states that the Dalit must educate their children. They must divert the attention of the children from God and teach them good things and send them to schools. She opines that when their children begin to be educated, they will be able to improve their condition. The another issue which had been discussed in this autobiography is the issue of aversion to Hinduism and casteism. So the another issue on which Baby Kamble focuses her attention is the superstitious practices of Hinduism followed and advocated by Maharsh. Diseases of the body were typified as being possessions of the soul by God and goddesses. Further justifying a person's death due to such disease as their entry into the metaphysical realm. This was because Maharsh had neither finances nor access to medicines, but mostly because of a culture against education perpetrated by the upper caste to keep the Maharsh from bearing the fruits of civilization. Dr. Ambedkar changed such fundamental thinking of Maharsh when he arrived in villages attired in 3-piece suit, exhorting them to aim better material well-being and give up on the lifestyle designed for them by the Hindu caste system. Baby Kamble remembers that Mahar women who were anything but rebellious up until that point in time could now go against the head male patriarch of the Maharwada in educating their children, adopting the practices of not eating dead animals and giving up superstitious rituals after the instructions of Dr. Ambedkar. These details validate her original argument of the cruciality of women in defying age-old customs and ultimately leading their people to prosperity, which was kept from them by the higher-ups in the Varna system. Also, especially this part of the book makes the title, The Prison We Broke, clear in its entirety. The superstitious practices forced by the Hindu religion's order upon the Maharsh for ages have been referred to as prisons in the title of the book metaphorically. And Bebita claims that Mahar women were instrumental in rising up against these social evils designed to keep the Mahars in professions such as manual scavenging, skinning of dead animals, and boot polishing, amid other practices which corresponded to lowly remuneration to ensure their animal-like existence for generations. So we can conclude her autobiography that Bebe Kamble, in her autobiography, "The Prison We Broke," thoroughly addresses the concern of Dalit lives in contemporary Maharashtra. She also agrees that the living condition of Dalits have taken a turn for better, and that Dalits everywhere owe their betterment to Dr. Bhimrao Ambedkar. However, she believes that the magnitude of his contribution to the Dalit caste is not understood in its entirely by younger generations because of their newfound socioeconomic rise. She also believes that the role of Dalit women in the upliftment of Dalit should not be disregarded as well, because they form as integral a part as any in spreading the gospel of Dr. Ambedkar and paving the way towards a better future for their children. So this is all about the autobiography, "The Prison We Broke," written by Bebe Kamble. Thanks.